The 90s was certainly an interesting time for film. It was the last decade of a millennium. A time of revolution, of new things being brought about. A time of many trends, and a time of quite a bit of variety within the film industry. Comedies, horror, action, romance, drama, period pieces, we had it all. One of the most interesting things to come about in film in the 90s was the outbreak of indie filmmakers who would eventually build their careers on their unique films. Robert Rodriguez, Richard Linklater, Quentin Tarantino.
What are you doing?
These, among others, are some of the notable filmmakers who, as mentioned earlier, started out independently in sometime in the 90s. But a decent amount of them, such as the ones I just mentioned, would find success, mostly because of their distinctive styles, with many of them having a recognizable look or some sort of director trademark to a lot of their films. This seemed to come as a result of many of Hollywood's blockbuster franchises eventually being run dry towards the end of the 80s, leaving a spot open for some more unique films by lesser-known filmmakers. Thus, in the late 80s, we started to get a bit of a prelude to this whole movement, with movies like Raising Arizona, Do the Right Thing, or My Private Idaho are prime examples of this, all by filmmakers who would eventually find quite a bit of success. One other thing that became kind of helpful to the career of some of these indie filmmakers in the 90s was the fact that the Sundance Film Festival was getting more attention and slowly becoming more prominent over time. This will be pretty important at some point, I think. At a time when more unique and independent films would get more attention, primarily based on the fact that people were probably getting tired of blockbusters, as mentioned earlier. Another notable big indie filmmaker from this time period is actually the director of today's subject, Kevin Smith. A guy who built a career on his comedies, mostly being over-the-top buddy adventure stories. So how did Kevin Smith get to this place? Where did it start? Well, that would take us back to 1994. Clerks was Kevin Smith's first feature film, and it's actually kind of considered one of essential movies in both the indie movies of the 90s and 90s slacker comedies. These were essentially films released mainly in the early 90s, in which the main characters would typically be unproductive burnouts who, as implied, slacked off. The attitude of these films seemed to stem from a common attitude held by many of the members of Generation X at the time, in which they seemed to hold a lot of apathy towards the typical American dream lifestyle, primarily as a result of America just recently leaving the Reagan era. The films very much reflect the feeling that Generation X are sort of the middle children of history.
The middle children of history, man.
Which is probably why a lot of these characters are made out to be so disinterested and sometimes borderline nihilistic, and Clerks was definitely no different from this. Movies like Wayne's World, Suburbia, Mallrats, even the appropriately titled Slacker, which was Kevin Smith's main inspiration for making Clerks, more on that later, are just a few examples of some other prominent slacker comedies from the 90s. Clerks is a textbook slacker movie, telling the story of two store clerks wasting away their day at work while simply talking and trying to entertain themselves, sometimes even getting up to mischief. But before I get more into the film's storyline, I should explain how the production of this film went, because it's actually a pretty crazy story. In 1992, 2 years before the release of Clerks, Kevin Smith really seemed to have no idea as to what he wanted to do with his life. He had dropped out of college and was working in a convenience store, conjoined with a video store, in his home in New Jersey. This will also be pretty important later on. One day he decided to watch a little movie called Slacker, essentially a vaguely plotted film following a series of conversations between people that take place in the same town. Its plotless nature does have parallels to Clerks, although Clerks does actually have main characters. And Smith himself has said this is the main thing that inspired him to make Clerks.
I remember seeing Slacker, and I remember really enjoying it and laughing along with the movie when I saw it. But the people around me were laughing hysterically, dude, like gut-busting, like knee-slapping, as if it was like a Police Academy movie, maybe the second one or something, when we still kind of liked it. So I was just like, man, if they think this is funny, I think I could make a funny film.
So after seeing Slacker, Smith decided to start writing the script for Clerks. A script directly based on his life, which he seemed to be making a statement on the rut that many Gen Xers were stuck in, as well as on his own kind of directionless life, seemingly mainly being aimed at audiences the same age because they would relate to him most. But before going straight to making it, he went to film school in Vancouver and dropped out again, thinking going straight to making his movie would be a better usage of money than going to school. Although it was at this school that he met Scott Mosier, someone who wanted to be becoming a close friend of his, and helped him to produce Clerks. Smith finished writing Clerks and then went back to Quick Stop, the store he used to work at, to ask his former boss if he could have his job back and for permission to film his movie there. And they accepted. After casting the film, he began shooting it for a budget of only $230,000, which is why it appears in black and white. But in the end, he made it happen.
The low-budget way in which this film was produced was a very impressive example of using what you have to make a movie.
And he put everything he had, not only, you know, blood, sweat, and tears, or his passions or whatever, but he also put, like, a lot of money into this, you know what I mean? And despite all the seeming effort put into this, Smith himself has said he kind of just wanted this to be, as he put it, a showcase film, because he wanted to get his next movie funded as soon as possible to try and make something with a bigger budget. To do this, he wanted to get exposure through paying it to get shown at the Independent Feature Film Market, or IFFM. Although, you know, let's not get too far ahead of ourselves.
Now to dive slightly more into the story, just so we can understand the characters, how it reflects Smith's life, as well as the attitude of many Gen Xers, it focuses on Dante, played by Brian O'Halloran, who has been brought into work at the convenience store he works at, despite the fact that he wasn't supposed to work that day.
Throughout the day, we see this sense of directionlessness through the way he talks about things, as well as the ways various other people talk about his life.
Oh, I hate this f***ing place.
Then quit. You should be going to school anyway.
Please, Veronica. Last thing I need at this point is a lecture.
That's why you're jockeying to register in some f***ing local convenience store instead of working on a steady job.
And she just wants me to leave here and go back to school and get some direction.
He still lives in the same town he lived in high school. He refuses to go back to school. Despite the fact that he's currently in a relationship, he's still not over his ex from high school. Not to mention she cheated on him 8 times.
She cheated on you how many times?
8.5.
8.5?
Eight and a half. It's a long story.
That's not cheating. People say crazy shit during sex. One time I called this girl mom.
And on the occasion makes real statements about wanting to move up in life.
What the hell's your problem?
This life.
This life?
Why do I have this life? I'm stuck in this pit, working for less than slave wages, working on my day off.
A very important reoccurring line that's sort of thematic is, I'm not even supposed to be here today.
Leave.
Not even supposed to be here today.
Not even supposed to be here today.
Something that at first glance might seem like he's just talking about his job, but in a sense, he could also be talking about his status in life. As the line gets more impactful depending on the moment that it's set in,
Dante spends most of his day passing the time by talking to a sort of other main character, Randall, played by Jeff Anderson, who works in the video store conjoined with the Quick Stop.
You're late. What the hell are you doing here?
Who's kind of a wisecrack, and kind of surprised he hasn't gotten fired from his job yet. A lot of the time, he annoys customers and gets Dante into minor spots of trouble, sometimes getting him frustrated. But at other times, he provides legitimately good information on how Dante should change his life.
Like how in one scene, Dante finds out he's gonna have to be in work all day because the person who's supposed to go into work for him is gonna be out of town for a while, even though he didn't get any word about it. When the person he's talking to on the phone questions his tone, he apologizes.
No, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to yell at you.
And then after he hangs up the phone, Randall asks why.
Why'd you apologize?
What?
I heard you apologize, why? You got every reason in the world to be mad.
I know.
Jesus, that seems to be the leitmotif in your life, ever backing down.
Back down?
You always back down. You assume blame that's not yours. You come in on your day off. You buckle like a belt.
You shut up with that shit. It ain't helping.
I don't yell at me, pal.
I'm sorry.
See? There you go again.
At some point, telling Dante...
And you know what the real problem here is?
I was born.
You should shit or get off the pot.
I should shit or get off the pot.
Yeah, you should shit or get off the pot.
And as crude and dumb as this sounds, it does actually wind up being quite insightful.
What the hell are you talking about?
I'm talking about this thing you have, this inability to improve your station in life.
You.
It's true, man. You sit there and blame life for dealing you a cruddy hand, never once accepting responsibility for the way your situation is.
Leave me alone.
Oh, you're comfortable, right? This is a life of convenience for you, and any attempt to change it would shatter the pathetic microcosm you've fashioned for you.
Randall is essentially saying that Dante seems to be incapable of improving his situation, and has never taken responsibility for how bad his situation is, which is true throughout the film. Dante isn't willing to commit to starting a new lifestyle by quitting his job and searching for something to make him happier.
And Randall says that he's only working this job that makes him miserable because it's convenient for him, and not risky.
Dante tries to call Randall out, saying his life is no better than Dante's.
Like your life's any better.
But Randall explains that even if his position in life, or job, does not seem desirable to certain people, he's still satisfied.
Hey, I'm satisfied with my situation for now. You don't hear me complaining. You, on the other hand, have been bitching all day.
Because he doesn't look for much more out of life than being able to just slack off all the time.
Which is where the film poses a very interesting question about these types of people. And it makes you think, is someone like Randall really wrong when he says this? Because if he's comfortable in this job and has nothing he wants to reach for in life, why shouldn't he do what he wants to? But Dante, on the other hand, is stuck in a rut that he can't get out of. And later, when Randall is gone and Dante is the only one at the counter, two customers walk in. These are Jay and Silent Bob, two characters who actually get introductions quite a bit earlier in the film, and they're essentially the biggest slackers in the film, as they spend most of their time standing outside of the Quick Stop and dealing drugs. Silent Bob is played by Kevin Smith and is something of a director cameo, and he, surprise, surprise, doesn't talk. Jay, on the other hand, is foul-mouthed.
Bitch, fuck your fucking ass. That motherfucker fucking this fuckers my shit, motherfucker sluts.
Unfiltered and never shuts up, and is played by Jason Mewes, who wasn't really an actor, but instead just a well-known troublemaker in the town that Smith lived in, and sort of a friend of his. After hanging out with him over time, Kevin Smith thought that Jason Mewes was one of the most interesting people he'd ever met, thinking that someone should put him in a movie. So when it came down to writing a script, Smith knew he had to write a role for Jason Mewes. Writing a role based directly on the guy's real-life mannerisms and tone of speaking.
Oh, look at you, I don't hang out with drug dealers.
Nothing personal.
It is in the scene in which Jay and Silent Bob come by the store, in which Jay asks about Dante dumping his current girlfriend to get back with his high school girlfriend.
Used to be my girlfriend, alright?
I used to go out with her.
Yeah, well, I thought we might be starting again.
Don't you already have a girlfriend?
Yeah, Veronica.
And what, you gonna dump her for that K-On chick?
Maybe.
But it is here that Jay points out that it seems Dante is taking his current girlfriend for granted.
I don't know, dude, that K-On chick's nice, but I see that Veronica girl doing shit all the time. I saw her rubbing your back, f***ing come brings your food, then I see her change your tire once.
It is now that Dante realizes he truly loves his current girlfriend, because she does really do a lot of nice things for him.
He's right. I love her.
So that's it. He doesn't love you anymore, he loves Caitlin.
Ow! What'd you do that for?
If you didn't want to go out with me anymore, why didn't you just say so?
After Dante's current girlfriend breaks up with him,
I don't want Caitlin!
You don't know what you want, but I'm not going to sit here holding your hand anymore until you figure it out. I've tried with you, Dante. I've encouraged you to get out of this f***ing
Then when he finds out that Randall is the cause of this, this causes them to get in a pretty big fight, ending in them having a conversation, which is perhaps one of the most deep moments in the film, and reflects the themes of Dante's life being directionless the most. Randall says he thought he was doing Dante a favor by telling his girlfriend he doesn't love her anymore.
Caitlin,
I thought I was doing you a favor.
Jesus.
Dante explains how frustrated he is with just everything Randall has done today.
What did I do that was so wrong?
What don't you do? You get me slapped with a fine, you argue with the customers, then I have to patch everything up. You get us thrown out of a funeral by violating a corpse, and then to top it all off, you ruin my relationship.
It is now that Dante drops the most impactful, I'm not even supposed to be here today.
You know what the real tragedy about all this is? I'm not even supposed to be here today!
Which results in Randall lashing out and delivering a speech that really showcases the deeper themes that I think can only be spoken for by being shown in whole.
Oh, fuck you! Fuck you, pal! Jesus, there you go, trying to pass the buck. I'm the source of all your misery. Who closed the store to play hockey? Who closed the store to go to a wake? Who tried to win back his ex-girlfriend without even discussing how he felt with his present one? You want to blame somebody? Blame yourself. I'm not even supposed to be here today. You sound like an asshole! Jesus, nobody twisted your arm to be here. You're here of your own volition. You like to think the weight of the world rests on your shoulder, like this place would fall apart if Dante wasn't here. Jesus, you overcompensate for having what's basically a monkey's job. You push fucking buttons. Anybody could waltz in here and do our jobs. You're so obsessed with making it seem so much more epic, so much more important than it really is. Christ, you work in a convenience store, Dante, and badly, I might add. I work in a shitty video store, badly as well. You know, that guy Jay's got it right, man. He has no delusions about what he does. Us, we like to make ourselves seem so much more important than the people that come in here to buy a paper or, God forbid, cigarettes. We look down on them as if we're so advanced. Well, if we're so f***ing advanced, what are we doing working here?
As much of a slacker as he is, Randall's words feel so impactful here. and they're quite true. Dante keeps trying to pin the blame for his motionless life on external factors. He seems to like to think he's so important and look down on other people, even though he doesn't have a very important job. And it's all just very thought-provoking. Perhaps even leaving the viewers thinking about their own lives, where they want to be, and what exactly the cause is of where they are now. At the end of the film, we see the two cleaning up the store, while Dante makes plans to hopefully solve his problems.
Going to the hospital, visit Caitlin, and then I'll try to talk to Veronica.
And Randall leaves, and Dante closes the store. Although interestingly, the film was at some point supposed to end with Dante getting shot and killed right before closing, but I guess that was too dark. Also, come on, we wouldn't have gotten a sequel otherwise. So what did this mean overall? Well, the film really seems to define two things. One, the way a lot of Gen Xers felt, especially the ones working minimum wage jobs who didn't know where to go with their lives. And again, it also directly reflects Kevin Smith's life, showing how exactly he felt before he decided to make this film, and put everything he had into it. Even from the 90s to now, the accessibility of nice cameras has drastically changed, with a good camera being way easier to access nowadays. But at the time, things were different, and as previously mentioned, Smith had to film in black and white. In the end, the film really depicts two polar opposites, two types of people, and I'm sure there were many Gen Xers like both of these people. One of them works a low-paying job, but is clearly very unsatisfied with that place in life. The other works a very similar job, but doesn't want to get ahead that much, and has an almost admirable enjoyment of his simple life. Clerks not only reflects the indie era of the time, but also reflects the way a lot of people from the generation felt, including the director himself. But even like I mentioned earlier, it is still a film that today could allow viewers to reflect on their own lives, and is still quite humorous throughout a lot of it. And that's how Clerks manages to age surprisingly well, and is still so important in all of the eras it was made within. Suzanne, you're all that I wanted of a girl. You're all that I need in the world. I'm your child, make me blush, draw me wild. Suzanne, you're all.
Of a girl.